did.
Well, I take this opportunity to welcome everyone to our worship service this morning. It's been at least a week since I've seen many of you, and I just want to tell you, you're beautiful to me this morning. And if you feel led to at any time that you want to in the middle of the service, just for a few minutes, just lower that mask, smile at me, and put it back up. Oh, me. But I'm glad to have everyone at worship with us today. And I just got a couple of announcements I want to make. I want you to understand, and it's in the bulletin. We're continuing to have our Sunday morning worship services at 11 o'clock, and we will do that through the month of February, and we will decide then what to do next. And I have a thank you card that I would love to read for you today, and it comes from Allison's team. God bless Smyrna Baptist Church. Open Hearts is so thankful for your amazing generosity. We had a wonderful Christmas, and blessing days were beyond our highest expectations. So many families were served, and we as volunteers were blessed to see their loving faces as we helped them fulfill their children's wishes. Blessings, and this comes from the Open Heart Ministry, and I'd like to say once again that they do a very good job up there, and thank you, Smyrna Church, for helping those individuals and that team out. Any other announcements that we need to be aware of?
Well, Bobby, there's some brochures in the vestibule about the air purifiers, and I had the wrong product, so please read that.
Okay, all right.
There's only 10, so if you got an email, let me know when I'll send
you. Okay, all right. Any other announcements? On your way out, you can pick up one of those brochures that kind of clarifies more what we had talked about Sunday morning about those units that we're putting on the air conditioners. Any other announcements? Okay, let's continue with our worship service.
Let's all stand again and sing, "Oh, How I Love Jesus." I'd rather have Jesus, hymn 550. While Miss Betty's getting ready, I want to let you guys know this week I actually decided to pick hymns that were in our hymnal for Miss Betty. I know last week it looked like Miss Betty had decided not to play the last one for us, but it was actually because I picked a hymn out of a different edition of our hymnal. And so Miss Betty sat down and thought, all right, I'm going to play it. And I thought she was going to play it. And we looked at each other and I thought, well, you know what? I picked the wrong song. So this week I told her when we came in, I said, "Miss Betty, I'm going to pick songs from now on that are in your actual hymnal so that you can play for us." So I appreciate you, Miss Betty. You do such a wonderful job every week. Let's sing, "I'd Rather Have Jesus." seated.
I'd like to lead us in our time of prayer this morning. I know there's quite a few that we need to be lifting up that's on the prayer list. I ask that you continue remembering Willie Musselwhite and his recovery from his surgery. Also, the family of Robert Simmons. Continue praying for Elaine Peavy and Miss Myrna Bailey. You might have others that you want to add to this list. If you'd take that little card that's in the holder there, and if you just give that, you just fill that name out, and we'll put it in the offering plate, and we will make sure that gets on our prayer list. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. It is with honor that we come to you, Father, knowing who you are. And you're the creator of all things. And we give you glory for that. That you've made us. Not only have you made us, there was that time in our life that you called us to salvation. And we belong to you. And thank you, Father, for your loving kindness that you've shown upon us. Even all the difficult times that's come our way and the way that our hearts are hurting for the lost in the world, and for those who are having difficulties in the world, and those in the hospital. Father, we know that you understand their needs. And we know, Lord, that we can come before you and we can lift up the families of those that have lost loved ones, and we can lift up those, Lord, who are having a difficult time in recovery. And we know that our prayers are answered because we come to you according to how the word describes we are to meet you. We come to you as a child asking for your great love to be bestowed upon us. Thank you, Lord, for those who are here this morning. My heart is indeed grateful for those who've been able to fellowship with us. And thank you, Father, for just the opportunity. You even gave us a break in the rain. And we're able to come and see a little sunshine this morning to just honor you and all the things that you've created. But then again, to worship you and to worship you as Jesus declared us to in spirit and in truth. And we thank you for being the incarnate God, the one who sent your Son, that we would know expressly who to give thanks to, who to worship, and who to glorify. And Lord, as we're here worshiping you, we pray that you would have mercy upon those not able to come. Healing is in store for them, we feel sure. I ask that you would just continue to be with them. Doesn't matter what they're dealing with, emotional pain, spiritual pain, all the suffering, just a physical issue there, Lord. We know that you are in control of all these events that come upon us. And just remind us that it's a test, and at the end of the day, we look to you, and we thank you for your goodness. And Father, I thank you that you've blessed us to be able to come together this morning and once again lay the foundation for a beautiful time of worship for you. And we do that in song. We do that in prayer. And Father, I pray that you would just listen to our prayers. We lift up the prayer you taught the disciples to pray years ago. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." But still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. And she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. "I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You were there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner from the sin that had me bound. I spent my days, I poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I'd found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and he filled my soul with the wonders of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's how I love him so much. I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You were there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love around me. Don't know the cost of the oil. You don't know the cost of my praise. No, no, no. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster. Want to give a word of testimony. That was such a blessing to me. I've loved that song for so long because we all don't know the cost. It cost, I mean, we know he gave his life for us on the cross, but
We all have our personal testimonies, and we know personally what he's done for each one of us. We may have forgotten it because it's been years ago for some of us. But if we just, that's how the season of COVID has dealt in my heart, is just to remember, to go back and remember that day that Jesus took my sins away, and where I was when he saved me, and where he brought me from. And yes, I still make mistakes, and I do things that aren't pleasing to him, but he picks me up when I repent. You can't just do all this junk we do and not tell God you're sorry and mean it with your heart. That's repentance. And then you turn from it and you walk anew, and it doesn't matter what the people next door to you know about you, what they've heard, what they've even seen maybe when in a bad moment. But his forgiveness cleans us as if that little old-fashioned thing we used to draw on and flip that thing up, and you young ones won't know what that is, but it was gone, and we could start Amen. All over again. And that's the way Jesus works in our lives. Yeah. And we don't know the cost. We don't know what Jesus saved us from and what he did for us. And I'm sorry if I just got to stand for the Lord, and he's been so good to me. And if you hadn't thought about your salvation experience in a long time, do. It's the same thing in your marriages. If things just ain't what they used to be, why not? It's because we need to think about what drew us to one another to begin with.
There you go.
And a threefold cord, if you and your mate know Jesus Christ, he's that third part of that threefold cord, and it holds. It's held for Bobby all these years putting up with me. I love you, Smyrna Church. I just thank you so much for just all the love you've shown us and support and everything. And so to God be the glory. Thank you again.
Do something with her, Randy. Don't break none of the 10, but do something with her.
Hey. Thank you, Miss Charlotte. Now, you can say she's sick, or you can say she's just glad to be here. I'd like to go along the lines that she's glad to be here, and she's got a testimony, and God just fills an individual's heart with a testimony, and then he breaks that bottle, and it oozes out all over the people who are filled with the Spirit of God. Which brings up, this has got nothing to do with the sermon, this is just a short sermon here. Y'all think I can't do a short sermon? This is a short sermon here. Did you know that God's design for every one of us, because we're all vessels that have been broken by this world. We're all vessels that have been broken by this world, but he picks us up and he puts us all together. First of all, that means that we're nothing more than crackpots. Now, you should let a smile run across your face just a minute for that one now, but if we're broken vessels, we're nothing more than crackpots, but every once in a while, if you're really a true crackpot who's following Jesus, when the world does crack you, you know what comes out? Jesus. That's where I'm headed, really, spiritually speaking, in my life. When somebody lets me have it the best way that they can with the world and things like that, when somebody, I mean, is just convinced that somehow or another, I'm the reason for all their problems and all their issues. Ultimately, when that hits us, when we're the problem with all of the world and everything, ultimately, when that hits us, what's supposed to come out, what's supposed to ooze out, is Jesus. You know why? That's who you're supposed to be filled with. And there's no room in there for the breaking of the ten or anything like that. No room whatsoever. If you've got that, sermon number one. If you got your Bible, sermon number two, Isaiah chapter 12. If you're timing that sermon was probably about 4 minutes. Y'all want nothing like that? Isaiah chapter 12, verses 1 through 6. And it really, it talks about the same thing that Miss Charlotte's testimony was about. I didn't tell her what I was going to preach. She may have slipped in there when I wasn't looking, and she may have grabbed a hold of my notes and realized that she needed to testify. But I think it's one of those things that, God has His own bulletin. He has His own way of doing things, and He wanted her to testify, and He wanted me to do a sermon on the joy of knowing Jesus. Now, joy, as we're looking at it this morning, what a scarce commodity this is, even in the Christian community. Well, Brother Bobby, I'm going to be joyful, but it's not going to be right now with all the things that's going on in our world. Why not? This is the time the world is looking for believers to have something different than what they're clinging on to, because they don't have life. They don't have eternal life. They don't have Jesus Christ. And so this joy that I'm sharing with you that comes from Jesus is not a passing emotion such as happiness. It's not based on circumstances or feelings, but Isaiah predicted this joy that would come from knowing who Jesus is. I'm talking about in a very special way. And in these six verses that I want to read to you, I want you to pay close attention to the verse 3 there. It says, because with joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation. Reading in Isaiah 12, verse 1, it says, and in that day shalt thou say, O Lord, I will praise thee. Thou wast angry with me. Thine anger is turned away, and thou comfortest me now. Behold, God is our salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song, and he shall become my salvation. Therefore, with joy shall ye draw water out of the wells of salvation. And in that day shall ye say, praise the Lord. It's one of the things that Miss Charlotte was doing, just praising God. In that day, can't nobody stop you, whether you be on the street corner, in church, or where you be on your job. In that day, when you go to thinking about God, you will say, praise the Lord. Call upon His name. Declare His doings among the people. Make mention that His name is exalted. Sing unto the Lord, says verse 5. For He hath done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Then verse 6 says, cry out and shout, thou inhabitant of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel in the midst of thee. Just a few short minutes on these great, wonderful verses in Isaiah, just to let you know that Jesus brings to us a special brand of joy. As a matter of fact, He said it like this in the book of John, chapter 17, verse 13. And those of you who are familiar with the Scripture, this is the longest prayer that Jesus prayed that's listed in the Scriptures. It is the high priestly prayer that Jesus prayed on behalf of His disciples and also on behalf of everybody gathered here and everybody listening under the sound of my voice. He is praying this for those who will put their faith in Him after the resurrection there of Christ Jesus. He is praying for us, and He makes this statement here in John 17, 13. And now I come unto thee, talking about God, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. We can have this joy of knowing that our sins are forgiven. From now throughout eternity, God has dealt with our sins, and He says and He declares they are forgiven because of the high priest Christ Jesus and because of the blood of His righteousness. Joy is a person. And that person is Jesus. He wants us to be filled with His joy. In John chapter 15, verse 11, this is the joy that Jesus tells us about. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy, Jesus' joy, might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This involves the abiding in the very one who brought to us salvation. It's not coming to Jesus for salvation, but it means staying there, abiding in Him. It means believing in Him and obeying Him. Let me give you a good thought here, a good illustration. I was about 9 or 10 years old when I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive me for my sins. Now, I'd already been baptized one time, but it didn't take. I mean, it really didn't, because I wasn't lost. There's a period of time when we were born into this world that you really can't call us believers or saved, but you can call us safe by the power of the God of all creation, because we hadn't reached that age of accountability. But somewhere around 9 or 10, I reached the age of accountability. And one Sunday night, God spoke to my heart. As a matter of fact, be honest with you, one Sunday night while I was sound asleep in a pew, I'd been accustomed to doing that for a while. It wasn't the first time on that rooftop for me, to be honest with you, you know. And I was sound asleep, but in the middle of the invitation, God woke me up. And as I was standing up to do the invitation, He spoke to me and let me know that I was lost. I didn't have any hope whatsoever. And ultimately, as I look back on it, because that's been about 55 years ago, my goodness, been about 55 years ago, but God was getting ready to transform me from the dark side into the light of eternal life. I was fixing to move from this realm of being safe, or if I'd said no, to the realm of being a Satan of child, a child of Satan, or I was going to be transported, transformed into a Christian, a believer, and I was going to be born again, like Jesus told Nicodemus it had to happen to him. I did not bow my knee or my heart to Jesus that night. I walked out. When I got home, the Holy Spirit of God was still upon me like nobody's business. I lay there in bed, and I knew that I'd made the wrong decision by not making a decision. My no decision was a decision there. And I called my mom and dad. And I told them, I said, "Now, I need to be saved." Daddy had no idea that God was speaking to me but about salvation. But I'm one that said those words there. Next thing you know, he and I, we were down beside their bed. I asked Jesus to forgive me for my sins. And He saved me. That's just it. As a young child, that's when the believing happened. But I told you, it's also an abiding thing, and it's obeying Him. To this day, I don't believe I'll ever forget that night, but the next morning, catch this now, the very next morning, the first thought on my mind and the first words out of my mouth when I looked at Mom and Daddy and said, "I'm still saved." Theology of a 9-year-old person that's just received Christ. I'm still saved. Do you know after all those years I can still say that? I'm still saved. I'm still saved. See, that's the joy of knowing Jesus. It means believing God when it appears far wiser to believe everybody else, even the experts. You know what they'll tell you? In the scientific world, they'll tell you that science have already proved that evolution is not a theory, it's a fact now. You know what I got to say to that? Their facts are wrong. You need to get your facts straight. God is the creator of all the things that we see. He's the Holy One. He's the one that created all things. And if you do some research, you'll find out this. Evolution is still a theory. Did you hear that all the way in the back? Raise your hand if you heard that in the back. evolution is still a theory. How do you know, Brother Bob? Well, I checked it out. There's been one fact that has been proven by Charles Darwin, all the study, 140 years after he's moved off of this earth, there's only one fact that they've been able to prove, and it was directed toward subspecies. Now, I want you to understand that we are human beings, and there's no subspecies when it comes to human beings like you and me. It has not been proven a fact, and it will not. Brother Bobby, can you prove that God created the world? No, I don't have to. By faith, we see that everything, it's Hebrews, it's in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, chapter 12, there. By faith, we look around, we see that everything that was made out of nothing by the Creator God. Now, I'm just sharing that with you, just want to let you know. It means believing God when it appears wiser to believe everybody else. It means defying one's feelings and fears and saying triumphantly, just like Jesus said in that moment of change for him when he made that statement, Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me, but if not, thy will be done. I'm telling you, there's a rush of joy in every believer's life when we can say that and lay down at night and say, Lord, your will be done. Something else I see in these verses here. Joy comes through submission. It comes from a person. It comes from Jesus Christ. And it comes from submission. Listen to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. It was with joy Jesus endured the cross. And then it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. Everything despicable in the world they were throwing at Jesus, from plucking out his beard, from spitting upon him. That's enough to make you want to put your mask back on, doesn't it? But everything that he endured it, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Joy is not created by possessions or by positions or by anything else than a person, and that's Jesus. Joy comes through service. That's tied real close to submission there. This means more than being active in church work. It means doing the Father's will. You might say, well, Brother Bobby, I don't know what God wants me to do. Well, think about it this way. Do you know what God wants you to do today? You do. He wants you to eat when you get hungry. Is that not right? Yeah, yeah. Or what does he want you to do before you eat? Pray a prayer of blessing. Brother Bobby, I'm all by myself. You never have been by yourself. Never have. You got Creator God there watching and looking at. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. Well, it would be if the Creator wasn't there. You know it's the will of God to be thankful for your food and everything that comes your way. Well, I'm a young man. I got into a really good fight with my mom and dad. What am I supposed to do? Be thankful for them. This is the stuff that will change the world, I'm telling you. I got mad at my wife, and I got mad at my husband. What is the will of the Lord? I'm sorry. That's an apology there. But everything I said was right. Well, did you say it in love? You know what the will of the Lord is today. Walk in it. Because the bottom line is, as you walk in it, you'll find out you're fulfilling His will, and tomorrow will be another day to fulfill His will. That's the submission thing. If I'm doing God's known will right now, I too shall have joy. So not only is joy a person, Jesus Christ, joy is a place. But it's not a happy place sometimes. but it's still a joyful place. Knowing and understanding that our sins have been forgiven, and that's the greatest thing that stops our relationship and the flow of the goodness of God from Creator God. So when we begin walking in the wrong direction there. Joy is a place. Joy can stand all the pressures Satan or circumstances can bring our way. Brother Bobby, you don't know my circumstances. You don't know my way. No, I don't. And if you were to tell me, I'd know more than what I'm supposed to know. You really need to keep that stuff between you and God. Can anybody say amen here this morning? I don't want to hear all that stuff. They had a friend of mine that was in the process of dying. I talked to him before in the past and things like that. He was in his 70s. He's getting ready to die, and he knew it. His wife knew it. His daughter knew it. And they called me and said, Brother, would you come and talk to Arthur was his name. And Arthur had been raised in a different religion. I'll say it that way. He'd been raised in a different religion. And it was calling for the preacher was like calling for the priest. Well, you know, when you call for the priest, you need to get married, or you're in the process of dying or something like that. You know, got to call the priest. Well, Brother Bobby came over there in his red truck. Not much of a priest. Loud mufflers on it, all that other stuff. This is just the way I was raised, I guess. No, I can't even blame it on Daddy. Came over there, and Mr. Arthur started telling me his sins. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. And I'm thinking, all this stuff's over my head. I don't even know your sins. And he looked at me kind of strange. I said, here's what you do. And I'm here, and I'll listen to you, to your prayer. But here's what you do. You're coming down to that moment of death. Here's what you do. You express to God your sorrowfulness, your sadness for your sin. He said, oh, you don't have to know about it. I thought to myself later on, you tell me all your sins, I'm going to go home and I'm going to fantasize what you've done, and I don't need that. Anybody's listening to me this morning, we don't need to hear this nasty stuff that the Word of God says should not even be spoken about among believers. But yet we dive into it. We love that stuff. They used to call them soap operas. What are they now? Moving on, preacher. You know what he did? Like a child, he started asking God to forgive him of his sins. I didn't have to hear one of them. He just clumped them all together and said, I believe in your Son, Christ Jesus. And I want to repent of my sins. I want to ask your forgiveness for everything that I've ever done. When he quit, he said, whoa, I feel different. 70-something-year-old man. You know how he felt different? At that moment in time. In that hospital room were the Baptist preachers, the furthest thing from a priest that you've ever seen in your life. I told him, I said, that's the power of Jesus cleansing you from all of your sins just because you ask him to. Joy is a place, and I'm convinced that's what it is. One more illustration here. I mean, you know, because I'm telling you, joy can stand all the pressures Satan or circumstances bring against us. Probably about 2 years ago, I was pastoring here. Down here in Dooley County, you have to look for people to talk to. In where I came from, Coweta County, people everywhere. But I was in my office and I was studying. A fella come to the door. And I think everybody that comes to my door when I'm in the office here, God sent them. What do y'all think? I mean, don't nobody know I'm there but Miss Charlotte and Jesus. And he was of another denomination, and I got to talking to him. I got to talking to him about salvation. Now, he could have walked out any time he wanted to. I didn't lock that door of the office on him. He could have walked out any time he wanted to, but I got to talking to him. I asked him, what's your experience? I mean, you're of another faith and everything, but how did you come to know who God was? And how did you meet him? And he said, well, I really don't know. I got baptized. Okay, that's good. This is awful. This is terrible. Except it's the terrible, awful truth. I said, why'd you get baptized? Why'd you get baptized? And we got to talking. See, the same Spirit of God still saves people and still draws them to salvation. Hey, let me share this with you. I am not exaggerating. I think Charlotte was calling, checking on me, because I was supposed to be home at a certain time, things like that. I talked to that young man for 4 hours. Make sure you got enough fingers up here. I talked to that young man for 4 hours. You know why? Because he wanted to know about this thing of confessing your sins and believing in the Word of God. Because he had never done that. Raised in this church here that they're real famous for their worship and they have wonderful worship and stuff. But for 4 hours, he was hobbled. He was tied to Brother Bobby and I talked to him. And he wouldn't leave. I got to thinking, let me just give that boy a gospel tract going about my business. 4 hours here. And there's a lot of things old folks have to do in the middle of 4 hours. Don't look at me like I don't know what I'm talking about. But he wouldn't leave. He wouldn't leave that room. You know why? Because he was scared to. And at the end of those 4 hours, and I don't think it's because he was tired of me talking to him, he had heard enough to bow his knees and ask Jesus to forgive him of his sins. Joy is a place. Joy is a place when you recognize that Jesus is the Lord of your life. Joy, how elusive, the writer tells us. It is something that you can lose all. You can lose Jesus' joy? Oh, yeah. Find yourself moving from a friendship with the world to trying to worship with God. And I'm telling you now, the worship's not going to happen. You can be friends with the world and everything the world gets involved in. You can hear all those nasty things that they do to one another and to everybody else and stuff like that. You can hear all that stuff there. But I'm telling you, joy is elusive. It's something you can lose. Joy is not a deposit placed in the soul after salvation without a chance of deterioration. Something will happen to it. This happens when we choose to go our own way. Joy in the soul can be eclipsed by our own disobedience. I will not. You know what the will of God is today, and you won't do it? You know what that means? This means you're, it doesn't mean you're not a believer. It means you're a disobedient believer. And I will not do it. I will not. Nobody can force me. I say that God can, but he won't. It's not the kind of God that he is. Might I once again remind you of David's one verse out of David's repentant prayer in Psalm 51, verse 12. Here's where it goes. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. David was a murderer after he had experienced God's salvation. David was an adulterer after he had experienced God's salvation. David broke up a man and wife's relationship. David, because of his sin, God said his son would die, but he came to Jesus. He came to God and said, restore to me the joy of thy son. It's elusive. Joy requires submission and service. And a lack of either one will rob us of the joy of knowing who Jesus Christ is. Got a couple of thoughts I want to share with you in closing about the way to enjoy indestructible peace and joy. Because this is how it's determined. This peace and joy is determined when you make these decisions for you. And I've got, for yourself, I can't bring joy to you. Be honest with you. If you want to talk for 4 hours, I'll be taking a break somewhere around that time, and we'll come back and talk. Amen? But these things here let us know that we know the person who brings us joy. We know the place that brings us joy. We know the submission that it requires of us to do whatever God commands, however difficult, even before He says it. I've been told now from the Hebrew, as you're looking at those Ten Commandments, that all of the people of Israel had already decided what Moses said they would do. As he was giving out the Ten Commandments there, they had already said, before they knew what the Word of God had to say to them by their leader Moses, they had already decided, and it's very real in the Hebrew there, that they had already decided they was going to do whatever it was, to do whatever God commands, however difficult, to endure whatever God appoints, however severe, to obtain whatever God promises, however seemingly unattainable, to die daily, however costly the crucifixion. I want you to know this morning, Jesus, known as the Lamb of God to the world, is known now as the Lion, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. In other words, Jesus didn't come from the Levitical priesthood. Jesus come from a new line of priests here. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And never again, oh please let me say this, and you're understanding it, never again will Jesus be treated like the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Y'all hear that? Never again will He be slapped in the face. Never again will He suffer crucifixion. Never again with his hands be nailed to a cross, His feet be nailed to a cross. Never again will He say, it is finished, because it is finished. Now, we might suffer all these things, but the next time the world sees Jesus, He's coming back as the Lion of the tribe of Judah in power and glory, putting a stop to all the nations in the world that have fought against Him, against God, since the foundation of civilization. I just had to put that one in there. You can curse God all you want to, but it's not going to take effect. You know why? Actually, the times you curse God will come back on you. So you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't do that. To die daily, however costly, the crucifixion. Here's another one. To love my enemies, however misunderstood I might be. To love my enemies, however understood I might be. To pray without ceasing in everything. For everything. Because joy is a person. Joy is a place. I'll close on this thought here. I'll save that for another day. Somebody asked John MacArthur how much, he's got a big church in California. Huge. And they've tried to shut him down ever since COVID opened up. He just keeps on rolling and going. They ask him, how much authority do you have in the church? Here's what he says. I don't have any authority at all. The only authority I have is to open up the Word of God. And it sure feels good when a Bible study teacher, when a pastor gives the people the Word of God, says, now you do with it what you will. This is the authority right here. You're looking for salvation. You're looking for the hope of salvation. Or are you basing it on some kind of religious observance? Religious observance won't do anything. Won't do anything. It'll cause people to speak highly of your name, but it won't cause people to speak highly of God's name. Oh, my goodness. I want to let you know. When the Word of God is being spoken, it's touching every heart, including mine. I don't walk away unscathed when I preach about the joy and the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know why? Because we're always in that period of growth. And I would ask you this morning, even in closing, make sure that you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. It's got nothing to do with baptism. It's got nothing to do with church attendance. It's got nothing to do with you doing the best that you can do. Bobby, was it all involved? Doing the best God could do, receiving that. And that's Jesus, the atoning sacrifice for his sins. Would you pray with me, please? Father, I love you, Lord Jesus, for the peace that you give every believer as they get up in the morning with their mind on you. And I know that's difficult to do, but Isaiah says that we can do that. And Father, Isaiah tells us in chapter 26, verse 3, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in you. Oh, Lord God. That's worth every search that we would ever do. That's worth every book that we would ever read, looking for peace in this world, knowing and finding it. It comes from obeying the Word of God. Father, I pray you just move among our hearts and our souls. And Lord, I'm here for further duty. And I thank you for allowing me to be used by you this morning. And I thank you, Father, for giving me the authority that comes from the Scriptures. It's got nothing to do with a denomination. It's got everything to do with eternal life. Move us all, Lord, in the right direction, which means moving towards you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.